So today we are going to look at using water in agriculture and in industry. Irrigation offers an enormous boost to agriculture, as about 25% of all harvested lands worldwide are using irrigation. Now that may not seem like a lot to you, but in India alone, the irrigated land represents about 66 million acres. That acreage represents an awful lot of grains that provide the primary source of food calories for millions of Indians. The boom of irrigation worldwide happened in the latter half of the 20th century, from the 1960s onward. Irrigation was a great thing at first and happened in one of two ways. Dams were built to store the water from a stream or rainfall, and canals or pipes were sent from the reservoirs out to farms, or wells were drilled into the vast reservoir of groundwater beneath the surface. This water was then piped into sprinkler or drip irrigation systems to water the fields. All of this was a wonderful thing, and many more lands were planted and harvested than ever before. But the gains were not without problems. Dams have ecological consequences, disrupting fisheries and aquatic life downstream. They also increase the evaporation of water, with the reservoir's high surface area, and so much of the water stored up gets lost to the atmosphere. A second problem is that irrigation increases the salinity of the soil. As water trickles down from steep slopes or is pumped up from the ground, it invariably carries salts and minerals with it from the soil from which it came. And as more and more water is used and/or evaporated, what is left on the soil is salt, more and more concentrated as more irrigation water is applied. Eventually, the soil becomes too salty for many plants. In Pakistan alone, millions of acres have been poisoned by high salinity, and overall farm yield is down 30% from historic high levels. Rainwater, on the other hand, is not salty, so rain-fed agriculture will not result in salty soils. A third problem is one that we are very familiar with here in Oklahoma, dropping water level in the groundwater aquifer. The Ogallala Aquifer is a vast, shallow aquifer located beneath the Great Plains in the U.S. It's one of the world's largest aquifers, as it underlies an area of approximately 174,000 square miles in portions of 8 states. In some places, due to extensive irrigation pumping, the water level is dropping more than 5 feet per year, and so irrigation may not be sustainable. It may be yet another example of how we have fooled ourselves into thinking that fresh water is unlimited. In fact, it is not. Industry is another big user of water. In some countries like the U.S., industry is our biggest user of water, using about 60%. Sometimes the quality of this water is left unchanged, such as when water is used for cooling. But before we consider quality, let's talk about quantity. In terms of quantity, industries are very different in their uses of water. 10 gallons of water is needed to refine petroleum into 1 gallon of gasoline. 25 gallons of water is needed to make just over 2 pounds of steel. But perhaps the biggest user is the pulp and paper industry. 86 gallons of water is needed to make just over 2 pounds of paper. So when we save paper, we're not only saving a tree, but also lots of water. Coca-Cola, like many industries, is starting to track its water use in order to look for ways to reuse or reclaim water. Coke claims that for every liter of beverage it produces, it needs 1 liter for the drink itself and 1.43 liters for manufacturing, cleaning, and processing. Globally, it uses enough water in a single day to provide all the water needed for a metropolitan area the size of Oklahoma City. But Coke has a big goal. Its CEO says that by the year 2020, Coke will become the first major global corporation to become water neutral. That is, it will have found a way to reuse its processing water continuously. That would be a very large step. Regarding water quality, water pollution from industry can range from heavy metals to highly toxic compounds that are not only poisonous, but also flammable. The Cuyahoga River in northeastern Ohio actually caught fire at least 13 times in the 1950s and 60s. The largest river fire in 1952 caused over $1 million worth in damage to boats and a riverfront office building. Fires erupted on the river several times between that fire and June 22nd in 1969, when river fire that day captured the attention of Time magazine, which described the Cuyahoga as the river that oozes rather than flows, and in which a person does not drown but decays. This fire was one of the incidents that helped spawn the environmental movement in the U.S. and resulted in the Clean Water Act of 1972. This legislation requires industries or anything that discharges used water from a pipe to make sure the water is clean to certain minimal standards, especially regarding metals and the most dangerous toxic compounds. Water pollution that is coming out of a pipe is called a point source, and because of this legislation, many of our polluted rivers and streams have become much cleaner over the past 40 years. To summarize, we enjoy many of the benefits that water provides us via agriculture and industry, but there is always a price to pay for this water use, both in terms of creating potential water shortages and in resulting in water pollution that affects both people and wildlife living downstream.